Hello again. We're about to get started with our next keynote presentation of the conference, Testing Outside of the Box, featuring John Bach. Again, I'm your host, Beth Romanek. And if you're just joining us for the first time, let me explain how to participate during the presentation. You'll be watching streaming video and content, so for the best experience, please close any unnecessary applications. You'll see a number of widgets at the bottom of your console there. Here you can view the speaker bio and presentation abstract, and you can also talk about the conference on social media using hashtag #StarWest. Use the moderated chat function to interact with the other attendees here, and I'll also be available to answer any technical questions you might have. We've got a quick introduction from Program Chair Rob Sabarin, and then John Bach will be taking the stage. Thanks for joining us.
Doesn't seem to be clicking to the slide. Thank you. That's okay. Welcome back, everybody. I like to think that it's a critical success factor that people actually come back, so thank you for coming back. I'd like to introduce our second keynote speaker. It's John Bach. John, first of all, asked me to express to you and to mention that he's on the other side now. He is a program manager. Of course, I told him that I don't know if there's sides in this, but what the heck, John? I said it, you asked me to, done deal. John and I worked together on a lot of testing projects over the years. We've been blooded in important projects that really made a difference in the contexts that we worked in. And it's been an incredible experience working with him over the years. We've also put together many peer conferences and helped to try to build community together. And I think that he's a person that I share a lot of values with, and I think you're going to really enjoy hearing him share his experiences and valuable insights to help us shape our professional careers. Please welcome my good friend, John Bach.
Thank you, Rob. Hello, testing. He just told you something that I was going to tell you, but I thought maybe it comes better from him that I'm on the other side, a program manager. I've been a tester for many years, and I wanted it to be this talk to be a bit of a confessional, because something happened to me when I became a program manager. I began to talk like program managers do about deadlines and milestones and dependencies. But that's my world. That's the box that I'm in. And I thought it would be a really interesting talk, and Rob said, okay, that we should talk about our boxes. So there are problems that threaten the value of the product. And that's what testers do. Or the on-time completion of the project. I test the project, the whole smash. And I think then that there's a really interesting set of things we should talk about boxes. Now, one really interesting thing just happened. Allison, at the beginning of the first keynote, she said, everybody wave to the audience and wave to the online audience, and I had forgotten that STAR is not just the people in this box right now. And that was an epiphany, because I'm about to do something in the talk that I thought, oh, people in the room, but no, it's going to go online like this real-time poll with the QR code that some of you have, and I just realized that's going to go out into the ether, and there's only 500 seats for that license, so I don't know what's going to happen. And if it's a bug, then woohoo, I'm still the tester ethos, I hope, because I'm surrounded by you, my dear friends and colleagues, who also have that mindset. Perhaps some of you may be program managers like me, project managers, product managers. And I'm really eager to see what's going to happen, because I have not tried this new stunt. But I wanted to hear what was on your mind, much like Jennifer and Jonna did with their keynote. I'm not going to have you turn to each other and break your little box and talk to them. I just want you to be where you're at and enter those questions in the survey. But like Rob, I too took some notes. And Jennifer said something like artisanal testing, and the tester in me kind of bristled and said, I think all testing is artisanal. Even if you're a programmer or an automator, you've got to decide what your art is. How, like, if I gave you all the same thing to automate, quote unquote, would it all be identical how you wrote it? No, you would make different choices, I would think. Maybe there'd be some patterns in all of your choices, but for example, oracles, or the principle or measure by which you decide if a test passed or tells the script what the oracle is, you may have different oracles for your test automation. So that's the tester in me that's still alive to go, interesting, I'll have to think about that. They said in their keynote, we see things other people take for granted. That's part of what I want to talk about, is we're all in this box. What do we take for granted, and so what? So what that we take it for granted? She also mentioned cell phones, like put down your cell phone. No, don't. I know you're tweeting. I know you're taking pictures. I know when I'm at dinner with you and you take out your phone and we're arguing about, well, who said artisanal testing first? I think it was my brother. And I'm like, no, he would never see something like that. You go, wait. Da, 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 da. And, oh, John, you actually said artisanal testing 3 years ago. I'm like, oh, I did? So the cell phone extends our conversation sometimes. You can't assume two people at dinner are on their phones texting to each other. I think that's unfair. It may be happening. But I know when it happens to me, I'm like finding the picture of my daughter when she was 6 years old. And I'm going, look, she's 11 now, right? So I don't mind that you're on your cell phones. I think I know what you're doing. Even if you're bored, I don't know it. You could be like trying to enhance my talk. So thank you for that. And by the way, thank you for coming back. That's another thing I'll say that Rob said. All right, so let me take off my testing hat, because this is a bit of a trademark for those of you who know me. I'm going to be a PM now. Let me put on my PM non-hat. I talked to Rob, I said, I just want to make a confession. I want to talk about being a PM and how I was a tester for so many years and how that's affected me. And maybe it'd be kind of like a Alcoholics Anonymous kind of thing. I need to confess to you what's happening to me, and maybe you can help, or maybe even better, you can relate to me. Because maybe you've done that switch from a tester to a PM, or maybe back again. Or as I suspect might happen, you go from tester to PM, and you are a better PM because you were a tester, because you never really forget what it's like to be curious, engaged, and on that treasure hunt of where's that problem that might save the company. As a PM, I have that. I still have that spirit, but I want you to judge and see if I really got it, so maybe it'll come out here. These are the boxes I think we're in. There's one. And see, you're not there. You're here. So yay, good for you. Your role, okay, tester, PM, those are boxes. Responsibilities. We have goals, we got our department, we got our environment, we have a team, we have values, we have culture. These are all very useful boxes. I'm not gonna say, get out of your silos all the time. No, boxes are very useful. They limit us, they constrain us in important ways. They help us focus. They give us purpose. But, you know, all of you testers out there, and maybe PMs and developers too, you've heard of out-of-the-box thinking. Well, to understand out-of-the-box thinking, you have to know what the box is. What is the convention? What is the normal things that people do when they're in the box? And of course, we have our companies. And that, I think, is why another reason that's good to have conferences like this, because I say, here's what we do at eBay, and here's what we do at Amazon, and here's what we do at Pinterest, or wherever it be. I'm eager, to the extent that you're allowed to talk about it, which I have to be very guarded about what I talk about on this stage, because eBay is sponsoring me to be here. So let me talk about that. Speaking of boxes, thank you, eBay PR, for this awesome slide, because we enable commerce. And so I started there in 2011, And that was my, to 1994, my 17th year in testing. I started in 2011, new to eBay. I was the director of quality engineering for search, the front end, the most popular feature, arguably, on the site, the one that is most seen by everybody. From there, 6 months a little over a year later, there's an opportunity. Like, could we need somebody who looks like who looks at things end to end in production? I'm like, that would be like a dream job, not just search, but the whole smash, like all kinds of things. That morphed into being a director for a tooling team that did automation end to end, right? Scripted testing. End-to-end with common scenarios, like buy an item, sell an item. Then this is when I became a PM, and there's a set of APIs within the company called Commerce OS that was the first, eBay's first chance at a standard, like as we as developers at eBay, how do we come together and come up with code conventions. Then I became a quality evangelist for a team that really gave me an opportunity to take everything that I've learned at eBay so far and do things like brown bag series and look at projects in platform engineering where I was at the time and look at patterns and see how I could be useful on what teams were doing across team. That parlayed into something called the Engineering Excellence Team, and I was the Engineering Excellence Lead. Same kind of thing, only not just in platform engineering, but in another department. And then last year, there was an opportunity to become an Agile coach, so I learned a lot more about Agile than I thought I would like to know or thought I knew, but the nuance of how it's really done, notions of Agile. When I say Agile, I mean notions of Agile, like Sprint, Scrum, stand-ups, usual thing. And then here's where I am today. I'm a PM on the RISC, in the RISC department, the Program Management Office. So I think about testing now in a very interesting way. I think about fraudsters and threats and threat vectors. And yes, we have a whole security team, but RISC particular is about risk in the transaction, onboarding. Are you who you say you are? KYC, know your customer. Anti-money laundering, collusion. Like, how can I protect you, all of you, from fraud? You don't get the item that you bought, it was just never there. It was a fake listing. So that, to me, is testing. It's like, who are you? Who you say you are? Are you conducting like fair and equitable like business on the site and not trying to defraud anyone, including us? But make no mistake, my dear friends and colleagues, I still like to find bugs. My daughter got me hooked on Pokemon Go 2 years ago. I confess, I am still in it. And so those of you who know, this is the trainer. He's supposed to be telling you something about a new Pokemon. And this is in production. One day, I'm like, what the? Quest_special_dialogue_Celebi.0.1. And it went on. I clicked next. And it was 02, 03, 04. And I'm like, Some server somewhere isn't responding, or some content team didn't get their stuff in on time. This is Waze. Anybody use Waze? Yes? OK, you recognize it? OK. Waze is a crowdsourced traveling app that helps me get to work. My work is up there in the top of the purple. I am at the arrow. I live in Morgan Hill. It is telling me I will be at work in 9 minutes. No, I will not. I don't know why it thinks I'll be at work at 9 minutes. I don't know how it wants me to proceed 20 miles north without getting there. I don't know. But it lasted for a couple of weeks. It would go away as soon as I started driving, but I filed a bug and let them know. And I think this is another app. It's just kind of cute. Whoops, something went wrong. We're sorry about the error. OK, I accept your apology. Now what? Now what? It says you need to connect to the internet, but notice I've got cell service and I'm on the internet. So what gives? So is that okay? Have I won your trust? I haven't lost it. I haven't lost it. But before I get into more about what the PM box is if you can scan the QR code. I didn't know this, by the way. I learned this a couple of weeks ago. You know your phone? You can take out your phone or your camera. Hold it up to this, like your camera. You don't need a special QR app. Hold up your phone, and it automatically will go bing. Am I right? Now, it may not work for everybody. So I had the one of my wonderful StarWest proctors here hand out a piece of paper, and maybe it's making its way around. And again, I don't know if it's going to fail or what, but what this is a real-time poll that I promised you guys. Now, how am I doing? Has anyone seen question one? Do you see something? No? Good, okay, it should say, yeah, wait for your presenter, because I tried different versions of this, and I'm like, oh, I know the audience is going to be like full of testers, and they're just going to go all the way to question 10, and it's like, okay, I need an app that allows me to control the pace of your great enthusiasm. And this is called direct poll. All right, so without further ado, let's take the next step together, shall we? I'm going to click this button called Start, and then I'm going to go to this screen. All right, good so far? Wow. Folks online, I don't know what's going to happen to you, but it's there it is. Feel free to participate. So if you guys in the control room can flip to my laptop so I can show the real-time results, that would be sweet. Because I have my browser open. Oh, maybe I have to do this. Sorry, guys. I will unhook, and then I'll go. I'll make it easy for you. Ah, the black screen of suspense. All right. Let me plug in again and send the bits. Hang on one second, guys. I'm unplugging, and I'm plugging back in. I heard the little doo-doo-doo and the doo-doo-doo. All right. Okay, so that's not going to work. So I have to do this. And I want to say duplicate. There we go. That's better. What best describes your current role? Tester. Oh, look, see, it's real time. Isn't this great? I've actually never done this before at this scale. So my vision as a program manager is to have an engaging, real-time experience with you all. Are the numbers moving? I think they were. Yeah. Good. So it's hard to read, I apologize. What best describes your role? Oh, you know the questions, you just answered them. I don't have to read them to you. Tester, good, okay. Next, what's number two? Automation engineer, okay, great. People management, PM, dev, or test, great. Other, ooh, other is four? All right, that's interesting. There are 14 of you like me. Wow, we are outnumbered, guys. You 14, 13 others? Or 14 others, I guess. It would be 14 plus me. All right. Okay, now watch this. I go over to here, the direct poll cockpit, and I say, next. And it goes like this. And go. You should have seen your screen flip. Right? Question two? Can I confirm? Anybody? Show of hands? Oh, sorry. Thank you. See, I'm in a box. I'm right there. I'm going to look this way. What kind of test? This is an homage to Michael Bolton, who an hour ago, when I asked him in the lobby, hey, Michael, do you have a question that you want to ask the audience? I'm kind of doing a stunt here. I'm riffing. And he said, yeah. I have a question. What kind of tester do they think? And he rattled off seven. I'm like, wait, slow down. What is that? What does social mean? What is that? He goes, don't worry about it. And I'm like, no, I'll put it in. So however you interpret this, this is fine. I'm just getting a sense of boxes. This is another notion of a box, is identity or affinity with a particular kind of testing that maybe you're not sure of, but it's okay. You can go by your gut feel. Michael, if you're in the room, there you are. Surprised?
A little,
okay. Well.
I'm surprised at the low numbers for things that have low numbers associated.
I'm surprised at the low numbers for things that have low numbers associated with them. Okay. All right. So the results are still coming in. All right. Good enough. Have you heard that before? Good enough. Sufficient quality. Enough means stop. Further testing and value is more harmful and wasteful. So I'm going to move on. I think you get it. All right, question number three. There are 10 questions, by the way, so hopefully I'll try to speed this up a bit. How many years have you been in software development? That includes testing. When you're testing, you're helping develop the product, so. Again, shout out to Direct Poll. They didn't sponsor me, and I didn't pay anything for this. So you guys, Direct Poll, you're rocking it. Thank you. I'm really pleased with this. And if we find bugs, Direct Poll, we'll let you know. All right, who we got? Wow. Every time I go to STAR, they tell me like 70% of you are like 1 to 2 years, and it's your first time in going to a conference. Okay, that surprises me in every good way. All right, good enough. Thank you. Whoa, hang on, slow down there. Next. Do you think there always should be a dedicated testing role? Now, guess what? KYC, know your customer. This was a really stupid question, wasn't it? Given my other, I didn't see end to end, I didn't even think this poll through. Take that, Dev Star. I guess, or SDAR, is that what it'd be? Software development, I don't know. Because development is testing too. Software programming. The software programming conference is going, oh yeah? Okay, I get it. But look at this, 340, so we can do a total. 94, that's like 450, good, we're within limits. Direct Poll is like, good, you're on a short leash, counselor. Don't go over 500. All right, have you ever transitioned between PM, dev, or testing, or any other role? So here's what I'm doing. I am testing an assumption. I'm assuming it's gonna just be off the charts, yes. But let me test that assumption. Now, there is a saying that drives me crazy, and maybe it does for you too. When you assume, you make an ass out of you and me. And I hate that because we make a million assumptions, and we're not an ass because of it. I think what that saying and that sentiment is supposed to mean is sometimes when you don't question assumptions, you might look foolish. And testers have to know, right, when to question assumptions and when not, when assumptions are okay, when assumptions aren't dangerous. I think that's really what it's trying to say. But I'm testing an assumption, and I am shocked that the no is as big as it is. So I'm glad I tested that assumption. Okay, wow. Are you surprised by that too? Anyone nods? Yeah, a couple people? All right, we can talk at lunch later because I'm surprised, but that's interesting. Question next. What do you most want to learn from others here at StarWest? More about their role, their culture, their project? Woohoo! Boy, you all have an execution bias like me. You have a friend in me, my dear colleagues. I can relate to that. What is the lowest? Their project. Look at that. So never mind the rest of this talk, because I was going to talk about my project. I have to be careful talking about anything about projects at eBay. So I'm kind of glad to see that you don't care. Really, war stories it's low. So much for storytelling, previous keynote. Yeah, happily ever after. Once upon a time, princesses and leaking dams. How do you implement Scala at your organization? Like, are you use Slack? Do you use the mobile app? Or do you replace your email with Slack? Here's what we do. That's what you want to know. Wow, okay. I hear you. Getting out of our boxes. Have you learned something really important in the last week? Like really important, like an epiphany, like, oh my God, that changes things. Or actually, it should be, how have you learned something really important in the last week? How have you learned? What is the principle or mechanism through which you learned something? Was it meetings? Attending a meetup? And this is, I think this is multi-select, if I remember correctly. So you can choose more than one. It's just going to give percentages, so it just takes the aggregate. Took a class, attended a talk. Of course, that's going to be high. Again, John, think, where are you? You're at STAR. What are they going to answer? But I did say last week, so I'm looking at the numbers coming in. Oh, I have meetings on there twice. Ugh. See? PMs make lousy testers. No, we don't. We don't. I just needed somebody to check. I'm looking at the screen for ideas. I just put that in to test you, and 7.3%. Something not on this list. Okay. So as a creator of this survey, that's an important element. I missed something. That 7.8% of you, or at least the aggregate, because you could multi-select, is I should consider next time I do this. Isn't that interesting? I gave myself my own requirements. I said, let me have the audience crowdsource those requirements, and I learned something new, that I'm missing a requirement that at least some of you have said is not here. Okay, what's the, took a class, okay, that makes sense. Next, I should just keep the mouse right there so I can just Alt-Tab over. What's the most important thing you need from a program manager like me? Well, not like me, other program managers. What's the most important thing you need from a program manager? All right, you other 14, listen up. Clear info, like milestones. Clarity on what decisions were made. This is what I'm hearing in my job, by the way, over the last couple of years, yes, as a PM, but more specifically the last couple of months. I am hearing loud and clear from developers and quality engineers and business unit folks, policy guys, security guys, this is what we need from you. What was the lowest? Other, okay. Tell me at lunch. Stop bothering me, 23. 24. Do I hear a 25? I'm glad it's not 195. Good. All right, thank you. Almost done. Has anyone from another role ever asked you what your job was really like? Yeah, that laugh is going to be the orange bar. And I don't mean like, hey, how's it going over there in test? Or how's it develop? I mean like, why do you guys like do this? Can you just explain to me, like, why do you always say, when are you going to be done? Why do you PMs keep saying, when are you going to be done? Isn't like a, like product owners, they're about the what and the why. And we, Scrum Master Agile Leaders, we're about the how and the when. So you stay over there, and we'll stay over here, but we can work together, and we can contribute to each other. But I love that kind of conversation is, why are we doing this and what are we doing? If I'm an Agile leader, I'm a Scrum Master, and if I'm a product owner, I'm like, how you guys intend to like fulfill my vision? Let's talk about that. Maybe I have some ideas. Okay, mostly yes, okay. And let's keep going. I think there's one more. Why do you think people tend to stay in their boxes? Why is Jennifer and Jonna like talking about, hey, put down your cell phones, we need more FaceTime. Well, the old school FaceTime. We need more time together. Have lunch with somebody else. Why are they saying that? Because maybe most of us like the way like things the way they are, or we think other people likes things the way they are. Second place, it's just too much work to find out what's in other boxes. It's just energy, mentally draining. That's what I'm intuiting here from this. Hey, what's in it for me? Nothing. It isn't rewarded. It's complicated. I'll talk to you at lunch. 33. And again, see, lunch, I didn't think of that, the fourth wall, the internet, the people virtually, so sorry about that. Although if you're at a meetup in the San Jose area and you know I'm going to be there, let's have lunch. We'll talk at lunch. Okay, interesting. I like the things here. I like that. And next. How could testing most be valued by others who are not testers? So I offered not sure, tie results or potential risk to business value, more bug advocacy or bug framing. Oh, this is something I learned the other day. I thought I knew what bug advocacy was, like fight for that bug. They say, oh, by design, or it won't fix, or not repro, or something that you go, what? You fight, you get back in the triage meeting or whatever the medium is in Jira, and you make a comment, you go, no, 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 no. Dinner with Michael Bolton, and he calls that, he'd rather call it bug framing. What are the different frames and lenses through which we can see the mechanics of this bug? I really like that. I want to use that more from now on. So I don't know, Michael, where you got it or if you invented it, but I'm sold on that. Okay. Tie results or potential risk to business. Okay, that's one thing. I only had 10 questions. It feels like 50 questions. Sorry, but I didn't realize. Does the real conference happen at lunch? Don't know, but let's talk about it at lunch. Or yes. See, I know my audience. I just knew it. Oh, look at that. All right, thank you for that. What that did for me was validate and surprise. And that to me is a profound thing, a juxtaposition between that. I'm going to try to go back to my slides. There they are. So let me segue a bit. Boxes. Have you ever been to an air show? Show of hands? Been to it? Yeah, okay. So there's a really, really big one, by the way, called Oshkosh, or Air Venture. It's in Wisconsin, Oshkosh, Wisconsin, the same place as the overalls, right? Oshkosh, Bagosh. And I've gone 3 times, but I was raised by pilots. My father was a pilot, my mother was a pilot, my stepfather was a pilot, my brother is a pilot, my other brother is a pilot, my sister is a pilot. Only one of us is, Rob, my oldest brother, is a professional pilot. He's an airline captain for American Airlines. And so he lives in Wisconsin. So I said, hey, let's go to Oshkosh. So anyway, I'm gonna play this little video here, if I can. Can I play it? I don't know. Oh, good. This is Sean Tucker. He's one of my favorite aerobatic pilots. I've met him in person. He's a super friendly, gregarious guy. Has some machismo, as you would expect as what they call a stunt pilot. I just see his aerobatic. Look at this loop. They call this the smallest loop in the world. Boom. That is a tight loop. That is pulling some G's right there. That is, I believe it's a Pitts P2A. It might be like tricked out, but all right. So what just happened there? So you could say a stunt, or you know, I call it aerobatics. You know, there's a diagram for this. There's a pattern in that what looks like chaos. It's called an Oresti diagram. And aerobatic pilots study these, and they plan out their show. And the loops and snap rolls and 8-point turns and all these other things. So they all can be communicated in diagrams to each other like this. Or the air show boss may look at this and go, ah, this is what you're going to do. Or the judges, if it's a competition, will look at this. Well, there's a particular box they can't go out of. For safety, for competition, for different kind of regulations. And it's like that. You may not have known that. Some of you might have known that. But isn't that interesting that it doesn't look like there's a box there, but there is. There are significant and important and meaningful limitations. I think we're in an air show box too, all of us. in our role. It's good that, in a way, that people identify me as a program manager, even though it may carry a lot of assumptions with it. I look forward to dispelling some of those assumptions and perhaps even validating some of those assumptions, your complaints that you've had with other, well, me and my 14 other colleagues, apparently, here in the room and online. But there's expectations and regulations, and it usefully limits the field of view. So you're not watching the whole horizon. You're constrained. It's important, and it's useful. And all kinds of cool things, as you saw, can happen within our airshow boxes. Interesting techniques and tips and tools and judgment and assumptions and how we bring that all to bear. Maybe even when you get back to your desk, what you learned here and what you're going to integrate. Maybe it's that one thing you took away from a keynote or a 3.5-hour tutorial like I did on Monday. And I meant it. If you remember one thing, great. That's great. I know, sorry it was such a slog to get through 3.5 hours, and I'll do better, but I hope there's at least one thing. Here's another box. If you're a tester, you are the black box. Tell me what happened, and give me some data about that. Like, back it up. I have a theory about what happened with, what is it, MH370, the Malaysian, the one that disappeared. Right, inexplicably, it's just, and my brother was like, unbelievable. The planes just don't disappear like that. It had to have been an inside job, basically. The captain of the flight, the first officer, had to have disabled all of those systems that track that thing. Because it's so wired for it to be found and be on track. So, not only do you correlate theories, you may inspire new ones with the bugs or the issues that you find. It doesn't have to be a bug. It could be a concern about the quality or the value of the product that you're testing. But it's the first thing, you know, that's sought after in a crash. And so are you. So are you, right? Can I get an amen on that one? If you're not, we should talk about that, because I am a consumer of your work, and we PMs should be consuming your work. And you should be crash-proof. This little nugget right there, I just want you to ruminate on that for a few seconds, please. Your integrity is on the line with everything that you do. Now, it may not seem like that, right, because you built up trust, and you can make mistakes, and there's some... Joshua Kurievsky is a thinker in the Agile space, and he talks about safety in what he calls modern Agile, as one of the components of modern Agile. Safety, emotional safety, being willing to speak up, being feeling like you can. And your confidence, perhaps, comes from the way you stand by a bug, or at least your confidence could come too, and the trust someone extends to you, by using safety language. Safety language, like, it appears as if this is a problem. It seems like XYZ. I'm not sure, but in the past, it's been a bug because, so you've got yourself an out, but you're not backing down. And that's important, because if you say, it's a bug, fix that. And you're wrong because you accidentally took a screenshot of an older build and you filed it as a bug, and it's like, John, you're killing me. We spent like 10 minutes debugging this and you are on the wrong version? Yeah. Yeah. I will go install the new version. But if I had said, you know, it seems to be that this bug is still here in the new version, and it's concerning me, but I could be wrong. And they go, yeah, you're on the wrong version. I'm like, oh, yeah, how do I check that again? I thought I checked. So I'm a little bit more safe that way. I don't mean being meek, but crash-proof means you don't make a mistake. It just means, like, be able to stand the impact of that scrutiny. Be ready for scrutiny. Because, I mean, you're going to make mistakes and not be perfect, but Another kind of box, the sandbox. Now, some of you actually have no sandbox as a test environment or even a production environment for your customers to come in and try their API, try your APIs or their integration with POS systems or whatever it is. So it's a safe space to play. You can, like I said, do some integration. You kind of find out who you are in a real sandbox, like when you're five. You kind of find out who you are, right? If you encounter a bully, do you back down? Do you fight? Do you, like, what do you do? And either way is okay, but it's a test. It's a test. We're all tested in this room, in our lives. There's expectations we have for ourselves, on this hand, and there's what actually happens. And if they're different, that's a problem. I expected this, I got this. In fact, in our bug reports, we say this. Actual and expected, don't we? Because it may be ambiguous. So there's an easy way to fix that. Fix it. Make the actual your expected. Right? Well, there's another way. Relax. Drop your expectations or lower them. Right? And that's really, that's like philosophy. That's like a way of living. So you can test in this sandbox, it says you can experiment, you can try things, do smoke tests, you can configure, and you can learn. It's a particular kind of box. It's like, outside of this box, you're not safe, right? In this box, though, you're safe. Like, I will assert to you that in this room, you are fairly safe. You're not on the stage, I am, right? And I know I'm being filmed, and I know I'm going out to the internet, and I know eBay is sponsoring me, so yeah, you can go. You can do a keynote. Let us see your slides. Let's make sure you're following the right template. And I go through the approval process. So there, but now I'm in production. But the sandbox is a safe space to play. And I think we should talk about that. Like, where do you feel safest? What kind of sandboxes do we have with each other? Where failure has low consequences, if any. Then there's a toolbox, and you all, that's why you're here. I'll just whip through this. That's why you're all here. Sorry, this is a little too fast. Skill, experience, methods, things like Docker, Jira, project management, those are particular constraints that you've given yourself. Now, they're weapons, and they're things that enhance your work, but they're choices that you can literally just say, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, this is my domain, right? And we should talk to each other about that. Like, what tools do you use, right? So I think, and we do that. I'm not saying, oh, start doing it. It's like, John, what are you talking about? This is a slam dunk. I just want you to be aware of it, like direct pull. I wasn't aware that there was such an elegant little piece of software for free, mind you, for what I'm using it for, that with the 30-day trial, that was a really I'm impressed. It did exactly what I hoped it would do. Now it's part of my toolbox. Had it failed, I would be like, meh, it's heuristic. I'm going to use it with 10 people. But now I'm glad I got out of that box and took a risk in front of you to try this, because it was lovely. I would do it again. Anyway, yeah, so what? All these boxes, John. Whole point I want to underscore is, yes, there are important opportunities that you will get out of your box. Now, I don't mean to talk down to you or insult your intelligence, because you know this, but I want to talk about three particular ones. And as a PM and a former tester, my call to action to you is, you have some opportunities here that I'd like you to take or work with me on. Turn rhetoric into action. Whatever you decide rhetoric is, from management on high, you know, CEO, like, you know, the world shops on eBay, right? Okay, I get it. Let's make it happen. Like, how do we do that? That's the what, and there's some why in there. How and the when, okay, how do we do that? So I like doing that. I want you to increase your influence, right? Because I'm worried about the state of testing. And in the keynote this morning, they talked about that, like the 47%, I think it was, reported that they were pressured by the influence of automation. And actually, I wrote it down. I'm just going to mention that. It was Has your role changed due to the need for automation skills? 47%. And I wanted to say, wait a minute. They should really ask, has the role changed due to the perceived need for automation skills? Because maybe management just thinks they need automation. And what they just need is better, faster testing. And they, so in the keynote, they said artisanal testing. I think all testing is artisanal. And, but there's opportunities, though, in the way we approach this problem of testing to increase your influence. I'll talk about it in a second. And third, elevator craft, similar kind of thing. How can we together figure out how to improve the reputation of our humanity in these projects? Okay, one. The leader says, we value these kind of things. And you say, I value these kind of things. And in the middle, there's something called a trading zone. And I think it comes from Henry Collins' work, Michael? Yes. And the border, the zone, is where I'm really interested in for the next three slides. How do you turn their values and your values into this thing that is we share? And as a PM, that's what I'm trying to do across team, is look at everybody's silos and say, what are your goals? What are you measured on? What are your KPIs, you know, your key product indicators or your OKRs? That's another way of saying it. What are your metrics? Like, what are you trying to hit? And let's come together and see how we can help each other get there and not just go, well, these are mine and those are yours and never the twain shall meet. That's one way to turn rhetoric into action is think about a trading zone. Whatever it might mean to you, the space between your box and another box. That's all. That's all I'm going to say. Just be aware that there is an interesting conduit between your two boxes. And I'm not going to try to tell you what that is. I'm just saying it exists. And knowing it exists makes, and that awareness gives you some power. Manager says, do this. You say, well, I have these other things to do. I mean, management talks about alignment, right? Like, if we could only be aligned. And I get it. I get it. Do this. But listen, if there's a life site issue and going on, like at your company, like a P0, and everybody's mobilized on it, and they're like, and at the end, they're like, you guys are heroes. I am impressed at this company. This team and this team and this team all work together to forestall this attack or make this bug, fix this bug in a day or turn around this new enhancement. Why? Because we had nothing else to do. That was the thing that we were, and that is just impractical, but it's, again, in the middle, your ability to influence or find what can be done is the mark of that. What's the difference with the delta and the trading zone between do this and we have these other things to do? Where can you meet in the middle? And finally, when a project manager says, oh, anyone can do testing, and you go, no, actually, testing does take skill. And you say, here's why. Here's what I did. Now, maybe it's obvious. They go, please don't leave the company. Your skill is absolutely vital. You're a bug magnet. I don't know how you do it. Keep doing it. So you hire a consultant like my brother, whomever, and they go, and you might say, I don't know how he did it. It's like completely random and thoughtless, and a skilled teacher will say, no, here's exactly what you did. Much like you go to an air show and you're like, oh, they're just flipping all around, isn't that cool? If you know what an Oresti diagram is now, and you look and you go, whoa, that's I can appreciate that. That's really hard to do. He's doing a snap roll from a lump shavak? Sean, dude, are you okay? You know, after he lands, he's like, ah, I shouldn't have put the next together in the Oresti diagram. I won't do that again. I pulled 9 Gs, then negative 8 Gs. So once you know what's happening in your chaos, it's just maybe intuitive to you. You're like, this is just what I do. It's just what my experience or my skill. Once you're able to teach someone else, and this is another reason to get out of the box, I think it's called the Hawthorne effect, is when you begin talking about your role to someone else, you actually, or maybe the Hawthorne effect is like when you're being watched, you kind of do it differently. Same kind of principle. When you talk it out, you don't realize what you've really got there. So that's a useful affect to it. So, closing slides. I'm counting on you guys, most of you in the audience, to partner, push back, be critical, all kinds of things. This is what I felt I was as a tester. And I'm bringing those into PM. As a PM, I look cross-team. There's 12 different teams that I can think of at the top of my head. And they all have different goals and different like ways they're measured and different things they're delivering. And you can almost look at it as a Gantt chart. And here's some milestones. And here's some dependencies. And they're going to be late. And ooh, that's important. And I should tell you that this, like, let's do this. One, two, three. Team one, team two, team three. Team one, team three is going to be late. And here's how late they're going to be. And here's why. But they've got a mitigation plan. And I called a meeting on this. And I invited 10 of you, not all of you, the 10 leaders, and invited you three leaders. And you guys in the middle, you should probably be like CC'd. Here's the agenda. Here's how much time. And I'm going to take the notes. Okay. Now, I'm not a glorified note taker, but that is one of the services that I will do as a PM, is action items at the very end. And then, so hopefully what you're hearing in this crazy narrative is, he's testing the project. He sees a concern that silo, 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 not talking, not talking, not talking. He's getting us talking, but not all together all at once, like the earlier keynote, like go to your neighbor and start talking. I'm like, ooh, no, I got it. I'm go through me. Now you could, that's dangerous in a way, because I don't want to be the bottleneck, but I will be a conduit. And that's, I know they may sound the same, but I have to use my skill and judgment to figure out how best I can get out of the way and enable you three teams to interact in a particular way. And that is, that coordination and facilitation is part of how I'm approaching, like what could go wrong on this project, just like what could go wrong on this product when I was a tester. All right, think of risks. I do. I escalate. I push back. Oops, sorry. I was reading, this is an actual magazine, fraud magazine, that I subscribe to now that I'm in risk. I was reading this excerpt the other day about a guy who went to prison for exploiting a bug. Thank you, Fraud Magazine, for this great story. So what did he do? This guy exploited this bug. You'd create the check. The program says, do you want to print it? And of course, you'd say, well, yeah. A prompt would ask, did the check print properly? And he found out that if you hit no, it brought you back to the previous screen. You could manipulate the check you've already printed. And then after that, you get to save it again, then pull it. So he discovered you could print a completely legitimate check and change the information to say something else. You as testers, now that that's in your head, you're not going to forget it because it's super cool. Like, woo, fraudster, I could have caught that. And you come to me and you go, John, did you think of this kind of thing? I'm like, no, show me the use case. Oh, wow, that's a good one. Let's meet to talk about it because that should go on a risk list. Involve and partner with me. Push back. Or if I come to you, it's more likely. I read in Fraud Magazine, I look at this, and I'm like, tell me we've got this case or this session, this exploratory session like planned in the hopper to do, to execute, and just kind of poke around at this. And you go, oh, yeah, yeah, John, this is like the first thing we thought of. I'm like, oh, thank you. You know, I'm not a tester anymore. I'm just like nervous, and I'm trying to be a good PM. And you're like, you know, trust us, John, we got this. Or it could be like, well, thanks, John, for bringing it to us. Hey, Fraud Magazine, what's that? Should I subscribe? And if you say that to me as a tester, I'm like, yeah, it's got some interesting ideas. Let's talk testing. I'm counting on you to expose risks and speak up when you're worried. Again, anticipate scrutiny. Let me know what you need. I may not be able to get it for you, but I can try. And I want to try. Argue your case. Celebrate your skills. I don't see it as much anymore. Testers high-fiving each other in the hallways. Not even automators are high-fiving themselves at their co-located desks. The SDETs, the software design engineers and tests, of which there seems to be abundant supply of, they're so quiet. These open office floor plans, where's the, yes, we've check this out, and people huddling around a screen like a NASA control center. So celebrate your skills. I'm saying that like in front of me too. Like here at the conference, we can do that. But hey, there are PMs. I wish there were more like who had that testing background. I can really appreciate. But maybe you're one of them. One of the 14. Okay, here's the deal. You do that stuff. I will do this stuff. I'll investigate. Give me a rumor. I'll go confirm it or corroborate or refute. Just like your tests. If you run a test. And you're going to do two things. You're going to corroborate it or find evidence to refute it. Okay, same thing. It's a kind of bug. A rumor is a kind of bug. Like, hey, I heard we have to ship a week early. And you're acting like we have to ship a week early. I'm like, I haven't heard that. Or, yes, I did hear that, but it's a misunderstanding. And what they're going to do is they're going to soft launch. And they're only going to release to like 4 people out of 4 million. So relax. Or it could be that you told me something new and I have to go and go, what? So that's what I do. Educate. You may ask, when did we decide this crazy thing? Like, oh, yeah, it was at midnight and there was a meeting on Saturday. And funny story about that. You weren't there. Coordinate. 1, 2, 3, what are you guys doing? Give a little, I might see your status report and your status report and your status report, and I'm like, I'll do an aggregated status report. And everybody goes, oh, we're all ready to ship on the 17th. And you get in my inbox right below yours, we're all ready to ship on the 12th. Okay, let's talk about this. Was that a typo? Please let it be a typo. As a journalist, that's my degree, BA in journalism, I'm like, I make typos too, please let it be a typo. Coordinate, what are the teams doing? Facilitate. Like scheduling deep dives, let's have a long meeting to discuss this. Ownership, is it team 1 that should own this? They're saying no. Team 3, they say no. Team 2, like, well, we kind of own it. And it's a TBD. And I'm like, it's a TBD? Oh my God, okay, let's do a tiger team. 1, 2, 3, one from each of your teams. Let's get together in a little tiger team. Is that cool with you? I'll buy lunch. No? So again, I'm looking for particular risks that are embarrassing, like really, we weren't coordinated enough to just do something like who owns this? Because and sometimes it's not easy. Ameliorate means to make things better. Give me, like you said, more clarity on milestones. You told me overwhelmingly, yes, John, do that. Elucidate, make it clearer. I love Jira. I'll whip up a dashboard. It takes me 5 minutes. If I know what problem you're trying to solve and it's ticket-based, or you're in the business unit, and you're new to Jira, I'm like, make it a ticket, assign it to me. I'll make a couple other ancillary tickets or supporting tickets. I'll whip you up a dashboard, a filter. You'll never have to worry about that again. We always see what's going on. Or advocate. Mike, hey, team 3, I just made a dashboard for team 1. You think, here it is, here's the link. Do you think it'd be useful? And you go, oh, this is great. Or, no, not really, we have this dashboard over here, and you bring it up on the screen for me, and I'm like, oh my God, I just wasted 6 hours of my life. But thank you, team 1, check this out. I built it myself in 6 hours. It's really, really cool. I too, like you, will ask questions. I'll provide the oracles or the principle, the right answer. Like, okay, the product manager is about specifications, but you know, I could wrangle what the expectations should be. I'm going to look holistically to find you find gaps as well. I actually help get them fixed. I'll report on project risks like you report on product risks. I'll triage and escalate your concerns just like you triage and escalate bugs. I'll give status updates just like you give up status updates. I'll keep you aware of milestones just like you keep me aware of how the testing is going. So see? I hope I've won some trust. I may talk like a program manager and talk like KPIs and OKRs and all these things, but at the heart of it, my dear friends, I love that you've given me a chance to confess to you my new role. I hope I never lose my testing ethos, and I'm here to talk more with you at lunch or wherever about your expectations of a PM or your context or whatever it might be. So thank you, and I hope to really talk with you later on. Thanks for your time. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks. Sure.
That was an awesome keynote. It started off as an outrageous pun, if you're familiar with the title of it, Testing Outside of the Box, and John's name is Bach, so it was sort of a pun and a challenge. And it was serious because this was a long discussion that we had, and we wanted to get audience participation really up there in the keynote talks, and we actually achieved that successfully with both keynotes this morning, so it's awesome that we did that. Takeaways I have, well, know about the box. Know about boxes. What box are you in? Hunt for the box. Let others in your box. Jump in, jump out. Share your box. Maybe sometimes you've got to turn your box upside down to find out what's in it. There's lots of types of boxes, more than I can imagine. Skills, tools, roles, culture, community, things, people, places, all sorts of stuff. So enjoy your life, but watch out for the boxes. Anyhow, awesome talk. Right now, you're welcome to enjoy the break in the expo area. And I believe the sessions will start in about a half an hour. I'm not sure exactly the time on that. So enjoy your break. See you all soon. Thank you.
And that wraps up this event. As Rob said, we'll be back in about half an hour with the next presentation. In the meantime, please check out the Presentation Center for the start times of the other broadcasts. And don't forget to join us for our live interviews between presentations. If you click the Interviews tab, we should be getting started with our first interview in just a minute. Thanks for joining us.